Good morning, and I would like to welcome everyone to this, the 22nd meeting of the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee in 2022. Our first agenda item is a decision for the committee to take item 4, which is consideration of a draft report on proxy voting scheme in private. Are the committee in agreement to that? Excellent, thank you. Our second agenda item is to welcome Liam Kerr, MSP, and his Movember with him that he's brought. Liam is the proposed deputy convener of a proposed group, CPG group, on ice sports. So can I welcome you this morning, and can you give us a flavour of the intentions of the CPG, please?
Yes, I can, convener, and good morning to the committee. It's actually a real pleasure to join you this morning to present to you this cross-party group on iSports. And as you pointed out, convener, I am the deputy convener, or I'm to be the deputy convener. My colleague, the convener, David Torrance, unfortunately is unable to make this meeting and tenders his apologies. The underlying reason for this CPG is that, as you will know, I'm sure, iSports have seen considerable growth, participation and viewing in Scotland in recent years. So sports such as ice hockey, curling, ice skating are making an ever-increasing contribution to those aims that we've set out in the CPG registration form, such as within communities, cohering communities, contributions to individual health and fitness levels, so support in the Active Scotland Delivery Plan, and on the local economy. You might also have seen, convener, it's a very exciting time for Scottish sports. Just by way of example, you'll have seen the recent success in curling. So you will know about the women's team winning medals at the Olympics, along with gold, silver and bronze at the World Championships, and the 2022 silver medal going to the UK men's team. Scottish ice hockey teams have made the Elite Ice Hockey League playoffs last year. At this point, I'll give a quick shout out to Aberdeen Lynx in my region, who regularly attract over 1,000 people, 1,000 spectators to the beach. And continued success and medals in ice skating, such as for Lewis Gibson and Lila Fear. However, there can be no doubt that these sports face significant challenges. So, for example, the cost of energy. Now, we know, you will know, that that is having an awful impact on so many areas, but significantly on the costs of things like ice rinks and running ice arenas. The challenges for local authorities, who principally, though not exclusively, it needs to be said, own these facilities, that have their own significant and ever-increasing funding challenges, which lead to them having to make very difficult funding decisions on both opening such facilities and, of course, accessibility to communities in terms of cost and physical facilities. There are obviously the implications of our collective and absolutely critical, let's be under no illusions, drive towards net zero. But these will provide challenges for these facilities. And of course, finally, the cost to the clubs, to the leagues, to their officers, to the coaches, the equipment of operating, and again, making sure that they are inclusive and accessible. So all of these, both the positives and the challenges, are set out as the purposes of the group in the registration form. And it is these public goods and these public challenges which make it so clear that it is in the public interest that this CPG come into being. So we want to start this CPG to celebrate what Scotland has to offer when it comes to iSports, to shine the spotlight on best practice within the different sports, to promote and highlight the impact of clubs and groups on the health and well-being of our communities and society, and of course highlight the challenges whilst bringing groups together to seek, agree and promote solutions. And when I say we, I mean it. We have 6 official MSP members from 3 parties, so the Parliament's criteria are more than satisfied. We've had expressions of interest from many other MSPs who, perhaps due to other CPG commitments, have not yet been able to sign up as members. We anticipate that further interest will be stimulated after we took the decision to shift the CPG's focus simply from ice hockey to ice sports more generally. There's been significant interest from sports bodies, clubs and other stakeholders in this CPG. So, for example, the Dundee Stars, Fife Flyers, Glasgow Clan, Scottish Ice Hockey, the Elite Ice Hockey League, Ice Hockey UK, Sports Scotland, Scottish Curling and the Scottish Ice Rink Association have all signed up. And we have interest from British Ice Skating, who we expect to confirm or hope to confirm as members next week. Convener, there are no other CPGs like this in Parliament, which is incredible when you think about the contributions that have been made, as I listed earlier. So I asked the Standards Committee to approve this CPG in order that this Parliament can promote, protect and celebrate ice sports. And I'm happy to take questions from your members. Thank you.
That's very kind of Liam. Thank you for that introduction. And I'm reassured because one of the things that obviously leapt out of the original registration form was a very narrow focus on ice hockey, which I think you've explained that it's now much broader with both the ice rink operators, owners, both local authority and private interested, but also obviously Scottish Curling. Members of the committee, who would like to kick off with some questions? Edward.
Just a question. A lot of what you've talked about, Liam, this morning is about facilities, built facilities within indoor arenas. When it got colder at winter, there used to be a lot of curling ponds dotted around Scotland where a lot of young children actually first learnt and had experience on ice. Will the cross-party group be looking at the extent of curling ponds across Scotland, their availability, and whether there's a way of preserving them? Because at the moment, there seems to be an idea that building over them is the way forward. I just wondered if you had a view on that.
I do have a view. I think it's a really good point, if I may say so, because this is a CPG about ice sports. And if we start from a position that says the curling ponds are about accessibility for some people to ice sports because facilities are not perhaps as extensive as we might hope. So if curling ponds are offering a way into these sports for people who otherwise wouldn't have that opportunity, then obviously that is something that the CPG not only needs to inform itself about, but also come to a view on. And if the conclusion is, as I think the member's rightly suggesting, that these are a public good, that these are about public accessibility, then quite clearly the CPG's remit would suggest that promotion of ice sports would lead to the promotion of such curling ponds.
I just think there's an opportunity there to protect what I believe is a public asset from being lost, which is happening in many communities, especially across the islands. So I've sowed a thought for you, and that's it, Convener.
Thank you, Edward. Alexander, can I come to you?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Mr. Kerr, for a very passionate presentation about ice sport. You've identified that there are really good reasons to celebrate, but there are huge challenges for the sector. Can I ask, when it comes to sports councils, lots of local authorities have a level of sport council that is there to try and promote and support individuals progressing through any of these sports. But the biggest challenge you have is trying to find facilities that they can go to. And many local authorities may now have, as you've identified, not be in a strong financial position. And one of the biggest issues you see is that people have to travel sometimes vast distances to find a facility that they can use to train on a regular basis. So can I ask, have you had any correspondence, negotiation with sport councils themselves as to what they are looking at to try and ensure that this sector of ice sport is given the priority that it does deserve across the country?
Yes. The question is a very good one because, as I said earlier on, an awful lot of these facilities are owned either by the local authorities, as the member knows well, or perhaps ALIOs. And in the current challenging situation, these local authorities, these ALIOs, are having to make some very, very difficult decisions, which will have very wide-ranging impacts. And I think, to turn to the substantive question, CPG has to inform itself at a very early stage from the likes of the sports bodies, from the likes of the local authorities, to understand quite clearly what those challenges are. Is it purely funding? Is it purely about how those funds are allocated to the local authorities and from the local authorities? Or is there something wider that's going on? Because only once we understand that can we work with those bodies and perhaps more widely within this Parliament to understand what the solutions might be. So what I would anticipate is the cross-party group very early on conducting that exercise, because I think the member's absolutely right. At the heart of what we're trying to achieve here is having the facilities to do it. And I go back to the question from Edward Mountain, MSP. Only if we look at this in the round to say, have we got enough facilities? Are the facilities suitably accessible in all respects that people can have them? And that's what the committee needs to understand at a very early stage. I think it's a fantastic question.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, Alexander. Colette, can I pass over to you?
Yeah, thanks, convener, and good morning, Liam, and thanks for a great presentation. I used to actually work in outdoor education for a charity, and part of that was skiing and snowboarding as well. So we used to start off taking young people through the dry slopes, such as Brayhead and Edinburgh and whatnot as well. And then it progressed more on a developmental scale. But the problem that they had was that a lot of the times the snow levels, like St Ben Nevis Range and, for instance, Aviemore and whatnot, and the obviously the impact on the climate change as well, climate emergency, and how the snow levels have changed quite considerably, which has had a huge impact on, you know, the developmental part of, you know, ski sports. So I was just wondering if that's something that you were going to consider in terms of, you know, how you actually, I know you as a CPD can't tackle that, but equally how you can progress on from there. And also as well, I'm keen to see not even ski sports being part of the curriculum for excellence, because there's so many positive outcomes from it. So I'll leave it at that. Thanks.
Yes, I think that's right. And the positive outcomes, I think the member would agree, would cut across all of the, I mean, in terms of the health, in terms of the community. So that's absolutely right. I strongly associate myself with that. In terms of the climate change agenda, again, Colette Stevenson, MSP, is absolutely right to bring this up. And it's why I mentioned the challenges of net zero, because we are faced, and a slightly take my own personal committee commitments within the Parliament in this for my knowledge base, and that's something that I do hope to bring to the committee, to the cross-party group, because we do face the climate emergency. We do face the impacts, and I think there is an exercise to be done by the CPG, which I think will add value more widely to the parliamentary discussion about what the impacts of the climate emergency are on the facilities that the member describes. But also, I think we need to wind into that this idea about net zero, because all of the facilities, whether it be ski facilities, whether it be indoor arenas, are facing the same challenges, and quite rightly, of the drive to net zero. And we have to understand as a CPG and as a Parliament how those changes are going to impact on the ability to put the facilities in place that, as we established earlier, we also desperately want to see throughout Scotland and see continue throughout Scotland.
Thank you,
Colette. Bob?
Thanks, Convener. See, Mr Kerr, this is a particularly interesting cross-party group, because it's making me think that doesn't always happen when members come here to seek approval of cross-party groups. So it made me think about the most obvious ice sports club in Glasgow, which would be the Glasgow Clan, which I haven't been able to go and see yet, which is probably my loss. But ahead of today's meeting, I thought I would just check what they're doing, and I see they've got Kids for a Quid offers to try and encourage young people to go and watch the sport as a spectator sport. And anyone who's visited Brayhead can't help but be enthused by the amount of families that go to see that as a spectator sport, a really family-friendly occasion, which got me thinking because of this cross-party group of the link between spectator sports and entertainment and participation. And I'm just wondering if that's something the cross-party group might look at, because we normally talk about sporting pathways, and the first way you get young people involved is you get them watching a real spectacle, and then they want to go themselves. And I'm conscious the aims of the cross-party group talks about access to existing infrastructure and promoting existing clubs. I would imagine that there's geographical inequalities in relation to some of those assets. I'm just wondering the relationship between growing the spectator sport, sporting pathways for participation and affordability. I don't expect the answers to that, Mr. Kerr, but I'm just very interested in relation to that connectivity. Mm. And it's made me think about it, particularly for North Glasgow, where I represent people. I know there are lots of people who go to watch Glasgow Clan, but I've never really asked myself the question about what's the sporting pathway for young people, and is that something that the cross-party group may look at?
So, yes, I think it is. I think it's absolutely the right tack to be taking that down and look at how we start that journey from communities that perhaps haven't been involved in ice sports, or indeed any sport, how we bring them along and how we channel them through into to get all of those benefits, the wider benefits that I talked about in my earlier remarks. What I would encourage you to do, Mr. Doris, is to look at something like Aberdeen Links website, which is probably the one that I'm most experienced in. I used to go and watch Murrayfield Racers way back 30-odd years ago. But I'm now watching Aberdeen Links. And if you were to look on their website, so first of all, I referenced that they seem to be getting over 1,000 spectators to home games already. So just as you say, it's a real... it's such an exciting sport, but you've got all of these people, families, as you say. It's perhaps more family-friendly spectator experience than perhaps other sports can sometimes be. So you've got all these families going in, seeing really exciting sport, but also, as you said, then the younger people particularly will be looking at, OK, I fancy trying this. Now, what you will find, if you were to go on the Aberdeen Links website, is opportunities for them to do just that. And not just for the younger people. Also opportunities for those of us who perhaps are not quite so young anymore. So those opportunities to then take your viewing experience and say, this is a really exciting sport, I want to get involved in this, into, OK, now I'm going to participate, are huge. And indeed, from my own experience, so I have actually played ice hockey with up in Aberdeen, and I can assure you that I was appalling at it, and shall not be doing that again. But it was entirely that experience. I've seen something that I thought, that looks great fun, and I've had the opportunity to try it. I think that's so important, just as the member points out.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. That sold your Christmas present from me, a ticket coming your way. Thank you, Liam. There is existing, of course, the CPG on sport, which on a much higher level or a broader range of sports is addressing many of the similar areas that you intend to look at. Have you had discussions with that CPG about your proposals, or is that something that, if recognition were granted, then you would undertake to do, just to see whether or not there's any joint research or to avoid duplication?
So we haven't had the discussion yet, but we have done the research, because I think, Convener, your point is exactly right. There is a sports CPG, and I think they will thank me for saying, I think their AGM is later today if members are interested in going along. What we were very careful to do is to work out what their remit is, to ensure that there wasn't a cannibalisation crossover, if that makes sense. So what we worked out was that the sports CPG does have, just as you say, Convener, a much broader remit. It's not specifically focused on the ice sports. So by definition, the good work that it's doing is much more unfocused on the ice sports. So we think there is absolutely an opportunity to have this laser focus on ice sports, and particularly the issues concerning them, just as Colette Stevenson brought up rightly earlier on, rather than the more broader scope that the sports CPG mm-hmm. is looking at. So we absolutely think that these are distinct, but just as you say, Convener, very complementary, and we certainly will be working or looking to work very closely with them going forward.
That's very helpful. Can I thank you for attending today? We will, in our next agenda item, consider whether or not to give recognition, and in due course, the clerks will be in touch with you. But good luck for the rest of November for the moustache, and I understand there is a giving page that can be identified Indeed. Through your Facebook page. So there's the advert for a good cause. Thank you very much this morning, Liam.
Thank you. I'm very grateful.
If we now turn to agenda item 3, which is indeed approval of the proposed CPG, do any of the members have any comments or questions that they would like to ponder with the committee before I formally put the proposal? Edward.
Can I just make the observation, far be it as I do on every one of these, to say whether it's right or wrong. It's just the number of cross-party groups that exist in the Parliament and the amount of commitment that MSPs are giving to them all. And I always raise concerns that another cross-party group, however worthwhile, will further strain the system. And I just think we need to be careful as MSPs. And that's my only comment.
No, and a very valid comment, and a one rightly made, which is why we have the intention as a committee to visit CPGs after the forthcoming recess, because there are a lot of CPGs that come before us. And indeed, I don't think I'm speaking out in turn saying that I had certain levels of concern about this on the basis of the application, but found much reassurance from what the proposed deputy convener of that CPG has said about the scope and breadth of it, and actually indeed the need for it. And one of the important elements about the transparency of this place is its access to groups that otherwise feel that they can't get to either their MSPs or through their MSPs to the Parliament. But point well made, and as always, well noted.
I'm content, and I'm never going to vote against a cross-party group because I think it's not for me to choose. I just raise concerns from there are more cross-party groups than there are MSPs, and it's just the amount of time that it sucks in, and it's just a caution.
Point well made. Do we have any other comments before? Well, then can I formally propose that we grant recognition to the CPG? Excellent. And we are in agreement with that. That concludes the business that will be held in public, and I will now move this committee into private.